Very, very good day to all of you. What a pleasure to have you back again every Saturday. Long back, somebody had told me that the greatest gift that you can give to a teacher is to come back and listen once more to the teacher. And that is what I get from so many of you. I really feel nice, including so many who, for whatever reason, are not free during the day on Saturdays, but they make it a point to catch up in the evening or on Sunday and go through it. But the main advantage of this is that this is an interactive program. So those of you who do spare this hour on Saturday afternoons, the advantage is that I get to hear from you, not only your questions and doubts, but also your opinions, which I think really contributes. And that brings me to this particular topic, that is learning from others' mistakes. Even before I talk about learning and before I talk about others, let us first define what is a mistake. Let's be clear on that. Because as I keep repeating, in human behavior, there's no right and wrong. What is right for one person is wrong for another person. What is good for one person is bad for another person. So obviously the same thing happens about mistakes. There are people who say that I learned from my mistakes and I am much better because I made certain mistakes. There are also people who say that, you know, the only way you do not make mistakes is that you don't attempt. So if you don't attempt anything, you will never make mistakes. So there are so many ways of looking at this thing called mistakes. I was reminded of a very interesting anecdote attributed to the Mr. Winston Churchill, who was the Prime Minister of UK. Winston Churchill was a very brilliant man, but he was also known for his very bad tongue. He would badly humiliate and insult anybody whenever the occasion arises. So he had gone for a dinner to somebody very high up, and the hostess, you know, was serving the drinks. And at some point, Churchill made a very nasty remark against her. She stared at him and said, "You know, Mr. Churchill, if I had made the mistake of marrying you, I would have put poison in this drink and given you." Churchill smiled at her, looked at her and said, "Ma'am, if I had made the mistake of marrying you, I would have happily drunk that poison." Now think, there are so many in human behavior of talking about what is good and what is you know, bad. There's another very nice anecdote. You know, a husband told his wife that you are a fool. And obviously people thought that she will retaliate. She said, "Yes, but you are a very wise man." So somebody was thinking that he's insulting her, and why is she saying that he's a very wise man? She said, "I am a fool because I married you. You are a very wise man because you married me." So every time, if you look at things, the main thing to see is that mistakes, when we call them mistakes, no, we should understand how to take it lightly. I will even say to failures, are you open to understanding that mistakes or even failures are a part of life and are these stepping stones of success? In fact, believe me, I am one person who is always very fascinated with people who fail. Whatever, it could be in academics, it could be in job, it could be in relationships. Whenever I come across somebody who has failed, I take more interest in that person than a person who has been perpetually succeeding and has been doing very well. Because I can only copy a person, but I may not be able to get the type of success that he has. But if I come across somebody who has made a mistake and who has failed, there is so much to learn from him, isn't it? A simple thing like public speaking. Since I have occasion to speak on different types of forums and, you know, different types of audiences and all that, I always keep an eye out for people who are not very successful in public speaking. And what I do is quietly, I sit in one corner and I observe this man. And I watch. he is not catching the attention of people. People are not happy. People are not getting convinced. And I ask myself, what is it that he is doing that is putting off his audience? And I will be able to then decide that this is what he is doing wrong. This is where he is making a mistake. So I should avoid it. And these are the type of things which motivated me to select this topic today. That is, you know, how much we can learn from the mistakes of others. We are very quick in criticizing others. Many of us, unfortunately, also have a habit of putting down others who make mistakes or who fail. And we say, look at this stupid fellow, what has he done? Look at that fellow, what he has done. But whenever this situation arises, do we stop and think, yes, he has made a mistake. Yes, he has done something wrong. He has failed in something. Now, can I learn from his failure? That is one. The other thing always remember is that success, or failure for that matter, is very, very, you know, circumstantial and environmental. Extensive research on this was done just after Second World War in the USA. Then US went to war, and the war really seemed very detrimental. It looked like Germany and Italy and Japan can, you know, wipe out America and the Allies. So what they did was they recruited every able-bodied young man into the army. Everybody compulsorily had to join the army, given a crash training, and they had been dispatched to various fronts. Somebody went to Africa, somebody went to Europe, somebody went into the Mediterranean Sea, wherever it is. When that happened, they found that there were many, many young men who were immensely successful. And they did so well in those 4 or 5 years of the war. They won medals, they got promotions, they got so many things. Then the war ended. And obviously the government of US could not afford to keep so many people in the army. So they disbanded them. Now these same people who had proven themselves in very, very difficult circumstances, in war fronts, in unknown places, in the heat of the deserts, or the vagaries of the jungles, they were successful there. They came back and they said, let me take up a job over here. Let me manage an organization or an office or whatever it is. And the funny thing was, many of them failed. Many of them just could not handle it. That is why behavioral scientists did a research. Why is it that this person, who could do so well in one circumstance, why is it that he is feeling so badly some else? And that is what brought out this theory that leaders are, you know, environmental. Leaders are for specific areas and specific expertise. So understand that you cannot be successful in everything. You will inevitably make mistakes. Be ready for that. Start acknowledging the fact that I will make mistakes. Identify the areas where I am more likely to make mistakes. I am not a good public speaker, so I may make mistakes. I am not good in calculations and numbers, so I may make mistakes there. I am not good at drafting documents and making agreements or negotiations, so I may make mistakes there. If you can identify which are the areas where you are more likely to make mistakes, it becomes easier for you. How? You start looking at others. And like I said, don't look at those who are successful. Don't look at those who have achieved greatness in something. Look at those who have made mistakes and had to suffer very badly because of it. And try to analyze what fits you, where you are likely to make these type of mistakes. Visualize yourself in the same situation. Suppose I was there in that circumstance which this person was, and where he made these mistakes because of which he failed. If we do that, we can really be very well prepared in advance to ensure that we don't make those mistakes. one of the most common areas where people make mistakes is in terms of building up a good marital relationship. How many times I come across youngsters who on the one side are saying, there's no such thing as happy marriage. See the way my parents keep fighting with each other. See, I see all my neighbors and uncles and aunts and all those people and how they're doing. Marriages are all, you know, just one long compromise and this and that. Nobody has a good marriage. And then this same youngster falls in love. And the person says, I have found Mr. Right or Miss Right. And now I am going to live happily ever after. If somebody were to ask them, and I do ask sometimes when I know that they're open to it, you yourself feel that so many people have made mistakes in their marriage and they are unhappy. What makes you think that yours will not be like that? You know what the answer is? No, I have found the ideal partner. So my partner cannot make mistakes. Firstly, that's not true. You're just in blind love. Secondly, even if it were to be true, your partner does not make mistakes, but what about you making mistakes? Either one makes a mistake and then the cracks start appearing in the relationship, isn't it? That is what I want us to understand. Why not look at others? Not just to criticize them and put them down and say, see, these people keep fighting or these people couldn't build harmonious relationship. And it's not restricted to marriage. I have seen parents, for example, you know, they are in touch with other parents who have got older children. They're having issues, discipline issues, academic issues, relationship issues. And they're getting very angry, they're getting very upset. But because I have small children, I don't bother because my small child is very, very obedient. I don't learn a lesson from what issues my neighbor, my friend, my sister went through with, let's say, an adolescent child. If I don't, you know, look at that, then before I know it, my child comes to adolescence and I have to start facing the same types of issues with them. How many times I have seen people who have blindly gone into something. In careers, for example, you may be a junior person, you're just following orders and you're doing your work. And you have this boss who's always stressed out, always making mistakes, always getting into trouble, always, you know, trying to rush. We criticize him. But do we actually sit down and analyze and learn what specifically is the mistake that he is making because of which he is in so much trouble? I don't do that because I'm very complacent. When I look at this person, I say, I will never make this mistake. He's a stupid fellow. He doesn't know how to handle the managerial decisions and abilities. When I come into that position, I know I will be able to deal with it. Why? How? What are your traits? What are your skills or what are your capabilities which are far beyond your bosses that gives you that confidence to say that? No, we are again blind. Like we are blind in love, sometimes we are blind in these areas also. And we don't even realize that we are going to be facing the same issues. In fact, there is this Hindi thing, no, which says, Saas bhi kabhi bahu thi. Every bahu who criticizes the saas does not realize that one day I'm going to be a saas. So am I learning the lessons, even if I don't like what my mother-in-law is doing, what mistakes she is making and whatever she is doing? Am I doing something to try and understand, you know, what mistakes she's making? So can I learn a lesson from it? Can I learn from her mistakes so that tomorrow when I'm in that position, I will not make those mistakes? This was a very interesting discussion that we were having even in Banjara for the last few days. The moment we said that we are going to have this topic, we started discussing. And I kept asking, and all of us kept asking each other, what have you learned from others' mistakes? And it was amazing how so many different viewpoints came in. So many different experiences came in. Yet I learned this from X, I learned that from Y's mistake, I learned this from Z's failure. So I thought we'll share some of them with you. Let's see what we can learn from each of these, and then we'll sum up the session for today. So here is Urmi.
Yeah, Ali, we are all here, a nice group to be sharing with you today. So maybe I'll ask Sonal first. Okay. Sonal, what did you learn?
Yeah, in fact, since Ali discussed about this topic, I was thinking, where is the major learning happening? And I could give the credit to the counselees. Again, as Ali said, it's an experience that helps us to understand what I shouldn't be doing. And that's what listening from different counselees about relationships and where what could have gone possibly wrong and how do I minimize that has helped me to deal back home many situations in relationship, because my huge and certain things keeps happening. But at that moment, how to deal that and how to make it, you know, peaceful for myself and everybody around. I think I give credit to coming back to Banjara and practicing counseling.
It's almost like a latitude you feel.
Very much. Very much.
Absolutely. In fact, if I can just share my personal experience, what had happened was I'd been to a mall. This is a few years back, but then that learning is ingrained so much. I had been to a mall and there I saw a mother who had a young adult son. And she was, you know, totally mothering him, if you can understand what I'm saying, that no, don't eat this, your stomach will be upset, and don't eat that, I think you should eat this, you should eat that. And I was just thinking, he's like all of 24, 25 years, and this is what she's doing. And then it struck to me, oh my God, am I going to do anything like this to my son? And I think it hit me so much on my face that I have to treat him as an adult. And it was a conscious decision taken that I'm not going to be doing anything like this. Treat him with dignity, respect, and as an adult who is capable of taking care of his life. And we also have some of the ladies first today. And then we also have this handsome young man, Colonel Vinod, with us. Vinod, what do you want to share?
Yeah, thanks for that, Woody. I would like to share something which is a very practical thing which I always do, and I think you can also follow that. You know, learning from or trying to learn from the mistakes from others. In a way, whenever I go for a long drive, I'm going to different places, especially when I'm driving through unknown roads or not very nice roads and or hilly terrain and all. I always try to follow. I pick up one vehicle and I try to follow. So that vehicle will be going at fast. I also go, I never overtake. I follow that so that whenever he breaks, I get adverse information. There is a pothole or there is a turning or there is a bump. So he may suffer, but in anticipation, I always save myself. It's a very practical thing, but then maybe his mistake or maybe he may not even make mistake, but then from his caution only, I gain. So I thought this is something which I always do. I will share with you.
So it is totally true live learning happening.
Yes, live learning happening.
Ali, we all have different things that we have learned our mistakes.
Yes. And it comes down to such basic things. You see, it's the attitude or the approach. Now you may say, what's so great about what Vinod is doing? Yeah, I know that will help. So what or something. But you know something, it develops that habit. That continuously, when you look at it this way, you look at the other things also. There are friends who have told me that when I walk into a restaurant and I see somebody ordering something, I look at his face and see whether he's enjoying that thing which he has ordered or not. So if I was in the mood to have masala dosa, somebody else has ordered it and he's eating it, if I just look at his face, I make out whether he's thoroughly enjoying it or not. Now there, my answer is there. No, it doesn't look all that great. Let me order idli. Oh, it looks great, that guy is enjoying it, so I may as well go ahead with my choice. It starts with these very, very small things and then moves on if you make that into a habit. And learning from others primarily, not just mistakes, but learning from others, from their behavior, from their attitudes, from their likes and dislikes, from their success and failures, is this one skill which we always keep drilling into our counseling students and even to our counselees here. And that is what we call as empathy. Unless and until I have built up this skill called empathy, I will not learn from others. I will either, you know, ignore them. Like I said, no, these people are like that. I don't care for them, what they do. And all. Or I become overtly critical. And I spend a lot of my valuable time only putting down the other person or criticizing the person or saying, why is this person doing that? There's something very interesting. Have you noticed? There'll be a lot of people, let's say somebody has a problem with someone else's behavior. So there's this person, you know, who is close to you. You can't get away from him or her. But you're thoroughly unhappy with that person's behavior. That person who is unhappy will probably tell you, I don't know why only he behaves this. I don't know why he's so nasty. I don't know why he's like this. I don't know why he does this. But the interesting thing is that even though he seems to be asking a question, why is he like this? He's not looking for answers. He's already got the answer in his mind. That is, this person is bad. This person is incompetent. This person doesn't know what he's talking about. This person always makes mistakes. So I just stretch it out by saying, why does he do it? But if I really want to, what I need to do is, at that point of time, find the answer. Why is he behaving in such a way which is a mistake and which leads to failure or complications? Why is he doing it? That is that skill called empathy, putting yourself in the other person's shoes or finding out the why behind the what. What did he do? He shouted. He got into a tiff with somebody. He took a foolish decision. Whatever it is, that is the what. Do I develop that skill every time when I look at somebody who has made a mistake or a wrong decision? Do I stop, think, evaluate, and analyze why he did that? The more we practice on that, believe me, the easier it becomes. And the more we can understand what is going on in other people's minds, what makes people succeed, what makes people fail. And based on that, there is so much that we can do. Along with that, there's another thing that if you do not succeed, if something goes wrong, or if you are attempting something and you are not able to achieve that. You know, there's a proverb which says, if you don't succeed at first, then try again. Somehow that proverb doesn't click with me, because there are people who keep trying. I know of people, for example, who have given the civil service exam 8 years in a row till they were no longer eligible to sit for the exam. Can you imagine a person wasting 8 years in the prime of his life with just one, you know, aim? I am going to become an IAS officer. At the same time, have you learned from others? There are lakhs of people who are trying to become civil servants and who are not succeeding. Did I even take the trouble of finding out? In fact, the credit goes to a gentleman who is no more. His name was Rao, spelt R-A-U. He was a Delhi resident and he wanted to become an IAS officer. He gave the exam once, twice, three times. He didn't succeed. He gave up. And you know what he started doing? He started coaching others for civil services. He said, this is what I know made me fail in the IAS exam. So now I will teach others. So you see, all his students learned from his mistakes. And believe me, he became so successful. He was at one time known as a sort of kingmaker, you know. People used to say that if he gives you admission into his coaching, you're halfway there to civil services, including my own elder brother. He was very keen, but he had absolutely no help, no connection. He graduated as a mechanical engineer. He had absolutely no idea how to go about cracking civil services exam. A cousin of ours who had gone through his Rao's coaching, He called him to Delhi. He said, you come here. And he introduced him to Rao. Rao took a rigorous interview of him and said, okay, come from tomorrow, I'll join you. And people around him celebrated, saying that, hey, guy, you almost made it because Rao has selected you. And that's what happened. He succeeded. He got into the IPS and had an illustrious career. So these are the type of people. Now, if Rao had continued giving the same exam, try again, I don't know what he would have achieved. But when he learned from the mistakes and he started teaching others how not to make the mistakes that I made, very magnanimous of him and very, very great of him. That is why we say that firstly, you learn from the mistakes, identify the mistakes, talk to them in a positive manner, in an empathic manner, in a compassionate manner. Yes, you wanted to achieve this, you did not. Or you made a mistake because of which this went bad. So I'm there with you, I understand whatever, all these things. And once I do that, then comes the question that how am I going to make a difference? How am I going to do it differently? So when you try again, you have to try differently every time. That is what the great Thomas Edison said, no? When he was convinced that electricity passed through a wire can create light and we can make an electric bulb. Theoretically, he was convinced. And once he started that, he started experimenting one after another. And every different experiment of his failed. He could not create a bulb. At one point, people got fed up of seeing him and said, Thomas, why don't you give up? You've tried so many times and you have not succeeded. Why don't you accept that you have failed? Edison said, no, I have not failed. I have learned 99 different ways of how not to make a bulb. And that's what happened. I don't know if it was the 100th attempt or the 150th attempt, but finally he did succeed. So firstly, learn from the mistakes. Secondly, understand the circumstances and the environment, how that has contributed to the failure. Sometimes it is time also. I know of people who came out with very bright ideas at the wrong time. And because of that, they failed. Subsequently, somebody else comes with a very similar idea, but he succeeds with that. There are innumerable such instances. I can talk so much about it. But the bottom line is this. Observe, analyze, and understand people who have made mistakes, not people who are super successful. Spend time with such people. They will be thankful to you because generally also nobody talks to them. Once you do that, check out how I am not going to repeat those mistakes. And then find different ways of how I can get about it. If you can do that, you know, your life is going to be really, really successful and you can achieve so many things which you may not have realized that you are able to achieve or you are, you know, competent enough to succeed in that. So with that, can I take my 1 minute break and hand you over to Purni? And then we shall continue.
Hi, back again. Yeah, it's nice to see nice comments and sharing of experiences which have come up. And what you can also do is, I was just thinking that, videos, they are all like on human dynamics, relationships. Hi. Yeah, nice to see you. Hi. Good afternoon. So, these videos are available on Facebook for later viewing. They are also available on YouTube. Okay. It just takes a few days for us to download it and then upload it on Facebook and things like that. I was thinking sometimes, you know, we do know few people who can benefit from, you know, they are doing some mistakes, but then they see it so closely that they don't get it that, you know, hey, I am doing something which can be, you know, detrimental to me and to others, right? So possibly what you can do is you can suggest them to watch this on YouTube. Not telling that, yeah, you have to learn from others' mistakes. Of course, not that way. What you can do is that possibly tell them, I was actually watching a talk and it was quite intriguing for me. And I learned this, you know, from somebody's mistake. And maybe somebody is learning from my mistakes that I'm doing. So I'm happy that I'm at least being of help to someone. Because of the mistakes that I am doing, I can reach out to few others who can, you know, take a leaf out of the lessons that they have watched me. So something, just a minute. Yeah. Just little adjustments happening. Thank you for the patience. So they are available on Facebook, so you will be able to, you know, watch it again and subtly, you know, ask them to also watch it, so that sometimes when we speak to them, it may sound like a sermon or why are you lecturing me or something. But subtly, if you know somebody can benefit, send the link to them or ask them to watch it. And that way, if we can, you know, reach out to more people, surely so to our loved ones who can benefit. I think these talks are available on YouTube and also on Facebook. So you can get people to join and like the Facebook page of Banjara. All right. So that was my small 2 pence idea to you. Over to Ali for all the questions, all the clarifications.
Yes, I already see some very interesting points in the chat box. Let me start off with connecting you to that. We start with Navina, who's been very regular on our Saturday talks. Want to share my experience. My Nana hardly takes my opinion. Mostly looks up to my hubby, that is her brother. I too have my brother and hubby. I treat my bhabhi with a lot of respect and dignity. Make it a point to ask her opinion, share with her and give her importance. Even before my brother. So yes, thankful to my Nanan for teaching me through her mistake. I could reflect this when you were talking about this, Ali. Thank you so much, Ali. Very important and thought-provoking topic. Yes, ma'am. Navina, that is how, you know, if you put it into practice, people like me, people much more wiser than me, can tell you so many things about life. But the actual result is when you start putting it in. So here you have. So Navina has a sister-in-law, her brother's wife, who has this habit of, you know, ignoring her and talking only to her husband, that is her brother. For whatever reason, we are not sitting here to psychoanalyze that lady. But when you realize how much it hurts me or how much we are missing out, I could contribute so much to the family, but she doesn't take my opinion. So what do? I have a brother and he has a wife. So I take that little extra care and little extra attention to see that I give equal importance to both of them. So we have more harmony in the family. We learn so much. We enjoy so much. That's why I said, even starting from whatever, you know, we know that said earlier and now what Navina said just now. It is these small things which make a difference in life. And the small things give you an opportunity to make it a habit to reflect. So I want to reflect how I feel when my sister-in-law behaves in this way. Once I understand that, then I look to the other side and say, am I making the same mistake that she's making? If so, how can I rectify? I can now make conscious efforts that I will, you know, involve my brother's wife. I will take her opinion and I will give her importance. And there you are. It's your life that is getting enriched more than anybody else's, right? Reena says, I learned a lot from my sister-in-law. I was reading a book, Chicken Soup for the Soul by Jack Canfield. She thought, that is a recipe book. I feel being judgmental will ruin relationships. Exactly. This is what we call as that closed mindset or fixed mindset, no? Here is somebody reading a book called, you know, Chicken Soup for the Soul. And the moment this person sees the cover that somebody is reading chicken soup, person makes up a mind that this is a recipe book. When you do that, no, you can never learn from others, whether it's good things or bad things. If the person is open and the person says that I will, you know, check out why is this girl reading, you know, about chicken soup? What is there in this? Is it a good book? Does it really give me something useful? As soon as I start looking at it and I interact, then she says, no, this is not chicken soup for the soul. This is meant for thought-provoking ideas and situations and anecdotes. And as most of you would know, Chicken Soup for the Soul has become a runaway success in, I don't know how many versions it has come out, dozens and dozens. And everything, every one of those titles have something interesting to teach us. Roshan Banaji says, taking lightly other people's mistakes requires a great deal of self-control. Yes, Roshan, I agree with you 100%. And more so if it affects us. So if somebody makes a mistake, wantingly or inadvertently, but it affects me. I am hurt in some way. I am, you know, feeling bad in some way, or I am suffering some loss. It becomes very difficult to take it lightly and to ignore. But if you just stop and think, what happens if I don't take it lightly? I take it seriously. And what happens if I take it lightly? From my perspective, it's got nothing to do with the other person. Do I be more happy if I take it lightly? Or am I more happy if I take it seriously? Based on that, I know where the answer lies. It still requires a lot of courage. I would like to share with all of you. It's not as easy as we think. But as I said, no, anything that becomes a habit becomes easier and easier over a period of time. Sridevi says, there are people whose life hasn't been kind to them, but they put aside their bitterness and go above and beyond to make others happy. That inspires me much. Absolutely, Sridevi. We were talking up till now about people who make mistakes or people who do bad things or whatever it is. Here is a good example to learn from the sufferings of others, not just mistakes. So as Sridevi said, there are people who have not made mistakes, but others have treated them badly. Life has treated them badly. But they chose that I will not become bitter. I will not retaliate. I will not hit out at others. I will not play that victim role. On the other hand, I will be nice to others. So to that extent, I can make somebody else's life a little better. And I can celebrate in their success or joys of life, thereby reducing the pain that I'm going through because of whatever circumstances I am facing. Yes, Sasha says, how to point out mistakes of someone. At the same time, it should be a lesson to others in a group. Yes, Sasha, I wish I had a stock answer, a simple or a clear answer to that. But as I keep reminding, human behavior is so different. Circumstances are so different. Thinking patterns and emotions are so different that there is no one single answer. How do I point out mistakes of someone? Starting with a very basic fundamental thing, do I even point out the mistakes? There are some people who do not like their mistakes to be pointed out. There are people who just, you know, who can become very defensive and your relationship can get spoiled with them. In those circumstances, it is better to protect myself and not point out those mistakes. But if it is a question of, you know, teaching a lesson, as Asha said, it should be a lesson to others in a group. So you're working in a group and there is one person, you know, who's making mistakes and you would like to use it. I think the best way of doing that is to do it very gently. Appreciate the efforts of that person who made the mistake. Appreciate the intentions of that person, that this person genuinely wants to do good. And then say, but this method has not brought him or her success. So can we try something else? Can I raise it up in the group and say, how would you deal with a situation like this? When it comes from third persons, even this person who's making a mistake takes it, you know, in a better manner rather than taking the criticism from you. Ah, we have Dr. Shirin, who's been with us for a very long time and who has been a very good supporter and friend of Banjara. Shirin says, our physiology professor used to say, wise men learn from others' mistakes while fools learn from their own. Very true, Shirin. That is why I took up this topic in the first place, that wise men learn from others' mistakes. But to do that, we have to be observant of others, firstly. Identify that they are making a mistake. Not get caught in the, you know, web of just criticizing them or putting them down or gossiping about them. On the other hand, talking to them, finding out what was their intention and why is it that they did this and what happened and all these things. Once you do that, then you will realize that things can be, you know, set right and improved on a continuous basis, instead of, as Shirin rightly said, learning from your own mistakes and being a fool and suffering because of that. Roshan also says, making others happy is the greatest achievement one can do, and not point out mistakes. Very true. Why do we feel this need to even point out somebody's mistakes? Why should we even comment on them? Unless it is from a constructive point of view. And when we do feel that there is a need to correct, please understand a very basic four-step formula. Number one, describe what the person did. Number two, tell what was the consequence of that to whoever is involved. Number three, talk about your emotions. I felt disappointed. I felt irritated. I felt frustrated. And most important, number four, give an alternative way of handling the situation. If you can follow this four-step, you know, formula, then it is not just pointing out mistakes. You can help other people also, and you can learn from them also, right? Yes, Navina says, normally we make a brownie point over the mistakes made by others, especially the near and dear ones, and quote those mistakes when we make mistakes and are being criticized for that. Yes, that you will see everywhere, right up to politics and this and that. One party says the other party did that and the other party did that. All those things. We see this on a daily basis, right? So Navina says, I was thinking it's important we empathize and come out of this vicious cycle and break the pattern. Exactly, Navina. That's what I said. Empathy is the key to all these things. So can I empathize? And what is empathize? Let's be absolutely clear. I'm repeating for the 100th time, I think. Empathy is not sympathy. Empathy does not mean you have to agree with the person. Empathy does not mean you have to have compassion or pity on the other person. Empathy is not even an emotion. Empathy is a skill. And once we learn that skill, so I empathize, as Navina said. What does that mean? I go into the root cause. As I said earlier, going beyond what the person did to why the person did. The more I develop that skill, the easier it is for me to handle it. I don't necessarily have to sympathize with the person, but knowing this, I can deal with the person in a much, much better way. Ah, yes, Shobha is back after a long time. Welcome back, Shobha. Shobha says, Ali, how do we tackle this issue when a family member makes the same mistake again and again? Right. Now, first, me, you know, introspect. How much is it affecting me? If it is directly affecting me, then yes, I need to do something about it. Right. well, it's affecting me, it's bothering me, or it's causing harm to me, or whatever it is. If that is the case, then I need to be a little more forthright. And I can do it by this four-step process, Shobha, which I said just now. Tell that you did this, this, this. Tell what was the outcome. Because of what you did, this is what happened. Then third step, tell that this is how I felt. I felt hurt. I felt demotivated. I felt pulled down. I felt angry with you. And fourth is, tell the person what is a better way of doing the same thing. Yet, let me caution you that human behavior cannot be controlled. The only person whom you can control is yourself, right? So even when you have a family member, Ashoka said, somebody very close to you, you would otherwise love that person and you would otherwise be very fond of that person and very close to that person. But remember that you do not have control. That person is an adult. If it's a small child, of course, there's lots we can do to bring about a change. But if we are talking about an adult, there is nothing that we can do beyond using this four-step process and hoping for the best. And as I always say, if you cannot physically get away from whatever harm that person's decision is causing, practice getting away mentally. That also is a very slow, laborious, and time-consuming process. But once you achieve it, you will not have to even think twice about it. People who do simple things like meditation, people who do mindfulness, people who learn how to control their own feelings and everything, all these people, you will realize, are able to mentally insulate themselves and continue to live with that person and that person's, you know, bad habits or bad actions or whatever you'd like to call it. Navina says, when I engage in a constructive conversation with the person who did something which according to me is a mistake, express it with emotions. They clearly state your boundaries. Yes, Navina, that's a very good thing. Always keeping in mind what I told you right in the beginning. What is your definition of a mistake? And does the other person agree that your definition is the right definition? Because a mistake can be different for different people. Even when it goes to the extent of morals and values and principles, please remember, one person thinks this is the right thing to do. A parent, for example, who's very strict with the child. So I want my child to become a brilliant doctor, engineer, this. So I'm going to go on and on, you know, pressurizing my child. And maybe that turns out to be a mistake. The child rebels. The child goes off in some other track. Now, at that point, what's the use of sitting and thinking that, oh, now I made a mistake? So you have to understand that there are ways and means of, you know, going about things, expressing it with emotions, and also clearly stating your boundaries and learning from others. I have considered a mistake. Instead of starting off straight away by being critical and pointing out fingers, why not ask the person, why did you choose to say this or do that? In what way you thought that this is the right decision to take or this is the right way to interact? I would like to go a little deeper and understand you more. And if I'm saying that with a neutral tone, not an accusatory tone, the person will feel open to tell you about it. Of course, there are 1% or 5% of people who are so self-centered and adamant that they will say, I don't owe you an explanation, get lost. With such people, it is very, very difficult. But there aren't too many such people. Most other people, when you do not confront them, but go into the basics of the thing, you will understand that it is possible. This is something which I keep on repeating every time. Human behavior is a slow process, but it works and it has permanent effect. So when you make it a policy to learn from others, this is what happens. Yes, Shobha, thank you for saying the thank you. It's all that I learn from you people only. Every time I get interact with different types of people, young, old, highly educated, illiterate, there's something or the other that I learn. And the only thing that I do is I make it a point to remember, note it down on somewhere if I feel that I will forget, and then consolidate it and put it back in programs like this so that I can also spread the message. Roshan says, very easy to preach, but a lot of effort goes in practice. Yes, Roshan, 100%, no doubt about it. It's very easy for me to preach to you how to become a tennis player. But how much effort it takes for you to be an accomplished tennis player? We don't think of it that way. When it comes to physical things, we don't mind. We say, yes, of course, it will take me a long time. I will have to get up early morning, go to the tennis court, practice every day, have a good coach, take part in tournaments. We do all that. And months later also, if you have not made tremendous progress, you say, no, I'm just learning, I just started learning tennis 3 months back, but I think I'm making progress. And I think in another few more months, I should be able to do good. Why don't we have the same policy for things to do with the mind? Navina says, certain mistakes cannot be rectified. Very true. How does one deal with it? Also, not make others feel guilty about it. See, one thing very important is that guilt comes from within. Nobody can make another person feel guilty unless you choose to. And similarly, even if nobody makes me feel guilty, I can choose to feel guilty when I've done something wrong. It's my conscience. So forget about the guilt factor. But do definitely focus on what you said just now, that certain mistakes cannot be rectified. Yes, that is when you need to look first into the physical rectification, to whatever extent it can be done. If you realize it cannot be done, then go to the emotional aspect of it. Can I at least rectify it in my mind? If even that cannot be done, then like I was telling you earlier, develop that habit of, easing off your mind, trying to slow down your mind, thinking properly, having positive thoughts, getting into something like meditation or whatever suits you best, and coming out with whatever ways to minimize those mistakes which cannot be rectified. Shirin says, yes, sir, the tone is very important. If it is not accusatory, the response is good. It really works. You'll be amazed if you can just at that moment control your own negative emotion, control your anger, control your irritability. Smile at that person, make eye contact, keep your voice very low and calm, and tell the person, this is what has happened, with the focus being more on me than on you. I felt hurt. I felt disappointed. And I request, if you can do it this way, then I think we can have a very good relationship, or we can produce so much better results. Sridevi says, our elders used to say that you don't have to burn your hand to know that fire burns. Suitable for today's topic, to learn from other mistakes. Exactly. All these quotes and proverbs which our grandmothers and grandfathers used to tell us, there's so much wisdom in it. You don't have to burn your hand to know whether fire is hot or not. You look at others and you learn from their mistakes. Somebody else put his hand in the fire and see what happened to him. That is enough for us to learn our mistake. And that we should do across the board. Wherever a person, I repeat what I told you right in the beginning, that we can learn more from people who have made mistakes and who are failures rather than people who are perfect and who are very, very successful, because we can only copy them. We cannot do things on our own. Okay, finally, Navina says, thank you so much for sharing your thoughts. You explained everything very beautifully. Thank you, Navina. I get very inspired and motivated when you people genuinely give such positive strokes. And Navina also says, today's topic is really very thought-provoking. Thank you so much for taking this up. And there is so much brilliance when we look into and learn from others' mistakes. And taking this thing forward, we keep coming out with all these type of topics. And I remind you once again that I am very open to suggestions. Anybody who wants to give any comments, suggestions or tips, whether it is what topics to be selected or if it is how we can deal with the topic. That's the reason why we announce the topics in advance. You'll see on our website that the topics at least 3-4 weeks ahead are announced. And Anis always puts up, when we are winding up this session, the topic for next week, which is attention-seeking behavior. Next week is 9th September, 2 to 3 p.m. as usual. Attention-seeking behavior, both in children and in adults. That's the interesting part. We often talk about children having this attention-seeking behavior, but we forget that a lot of adults also do it in a different way. So any suggestions, any inputs, please give it to me. Send me a mail or call up or whatever. And then join us next Saturday, that is of 9th September at 2 o'clock, to talk about how both children and adults do what we call as attention-seeking behavior. Have a wonderful day. Bye-bye and thank you all.